Good morning. Thank you so much, Lorraine. A few announcements before we start our worship. The Lord's Supper will be celebrated next week when Pastor Luke and Amy are back. We want to thank you all for your prayers for us, for Victoria and I and Pastor and Amy as we went to GA in St. Louis. Thank you so much. It's very good to be home. And Victoria asked me to mention, as it says in the bulletin, she could use a few good hands to help put together the decorations and set for VBS from August 2nd to the 5th at the Grundy County Fairgrounds. You would only need to help set up and possibly then tear down. So those are our announcements. And now as we get ready to worship our God, let us stand for our call to worship. Call to worship today is taken from Psalm 8, one of my favorite psalms. What a beautiful, beautiful psalms. I will do the leader part, and of course you will do the people part. Let's say it with vigor and enthusiasm. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the Son of Man that you care for him? All sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas, and altogether, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Let us respond with singing that great hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, hymn number 36, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Lord, all is thee,
may be seated. The first worship service in General Assembly is much more of a formal worship service, and we share the Lord's Supper, and the first speaker spoke of heaven and the importance to remember heaven every day and think about it and to enjoy the thoughts of heaven. And then as we went toward the Lord's Supper, we had our call to confession, and he said, "We won't need this in heaven." And it was a simple statement, but if you were in the crowd, it was almost overwhelming, because you realized we will not sin in heaven. Sometimes we need to remember that. There will be no need for the call to confession, nor the assurance of pardon, because we will not know sin. That is a huge, huge thing. But we are still here. The Lord has not returned yet. We are still sinning. And so our call to confession comes from Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24. "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." We'll have a moment of silence, and then I'll close with a word of prayer of adoration and confession. Who is like unto thee, O Lord? Your name is majestic in all of the earth. You are holy, and we are sinners. So we ask you to search us, Lord, to know our hearts, and to lead us in the way that is everlasting. And we ask this in our blessed Savior's name. Amen. Our assurance of pardon comes from 1 John 1, verse 9. "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Will the deacons come forth? Do we have any to collect offering? Have any deacons today? Got anybody? Paul? Grab a couple people for offering. Let us pray. We give thee but thine own, whatever that gift may be. All, everything that we have, Father, comes through your hand. May we be giving joyfully and happily to give it back to you. We just pray that you will bless this offering as part of our worship. Thank you so much for each of your gifts. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Now let us stand and sing our praise and celebration hymn, the Great Hymns of Faith, 125, Jesus Paid It All, all four verses of 125, Jesus Paid It All. In our confession of faith found in the New City Catechism, question and answer 36, I'll read the question and we'll read the answer together. What do we believe about the Holy Spirit? That he is God, co-eternal with the Father and the Son, and that God grants him irrevocably to all who believe. Please be seated. And we'll join together in a prayer, a time of prayer of thanksgiving and supplication. Let us come before our God. Heavenly Father, we do come before you with our hearts full of thanksgiving, for you continue to bless your people. You have answered our prayers, and we are so grateful that you are a loving and gracious God. We come before you asking to bless this country as we celebrate its 245th birthday. This country seems to be out of control, but you use things, Father, and you use this to drive your people to earnest and heartfelt prayer. May we continue our prayers. Bless our president and all of our leaders. Give them a heart to seek your wisdom and your will. Continue to bless our church. It has stood for 150 years proclaiming the truth of the gospel. May it continue until you come again. We pray for our denomination, the PCA denomination, may it continue to stand on the Bible and look to it for inspiration and for truth. We pray for the meeting of the Iowa Presbytery that'll be here Saturday. We continue to, Father, to pray for Pat Neeson's family as they mourn their loss. We pray for Samantha Lamper's upcoming surgery. We pray that you will bless her and strengthen her. We pray continually for Rod Schwab, that you will be with him as he recovers, and Kim Venega and Landon Harberts, and my mom, Adela, as she continues to struggle after surgery. We pray that you will be with them all. Bless them, Father. We pray for Pastor Luke and Amy and their family as they finish up vacation. We pray, Father, that you will bring them home safely as they take up their work here. We're thankful that they are here to serve us. And we pray now, Father, for Dean as he brings forward the word to us. May our hearts be changed and our minds transformed. In Jesus' name, we ask this all. Amen. Thank you, Dean, for doing two in a row and for and for doing this. We appreciate it so much. Thank you, brother.
You're welcome, Dave. Thank you. Thank you for representing Iowa Presbytery, right, at GA. I understand that was a busy week, and I heard Victoria got to enjoy St. Louis and some good company, right, with another woman of faith. And yeah, thank you for coming to church this morning. God bless America, as we heard those Luray play the music to God Bless America. I was singing it in my head. Today is the 245th birthday of the United States of America. And we are here in part to let freedom ring. Right, Joyce? Joyce sent me a message this just a couple days ago. She forwarded the Gaither Vocal Band's presentation of Let Freedom Ring. And was it the New York Cathedral? Oh, Carnegie Hall. Carnegie Hall. Beautiful. Beautiful. I encourage you to look that up. Let Freedom Ring. We are here to celebrate freedom today. And we celebrate those freedoms because we've been born into the United States of America, right? Or we're residents of the United States of America. And this is a part two of our series. Last week we looked at what it is to be born of God, right? From John chapter 1. Anybody do their homework assignment this week? I know Christy did. I don't want to put you on the spot. But the Gospel of John. And Christy and I went walking yesterday, and I asked her, as I had worked all week, I asked her if she did her homework assignment, and she said yes. And Christy is a wonderful student of the Bible. She takes really good notes. And I asked her what she got out of the book of John, and she said, you know, John's gospel stands alone in the four gospels. It comes after the first three. The first three gospels are Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Those are what are referred to as the synoptic gospels. They tell the narrative of Jesus' birth, life, ministry, death, resurrection. But John stands alone. It's written after the first three, and it's just filled with the words of Jesus. Jesus, so many. And again, I just encourage you, if you didn't this week, whenever you're in a position of just wondering again, because we all have doubts, who this Jesus is, read the Gospel of John. Listen to the Gospel of John. Bible.is was the one I recommended last week, the app, but there are many. And we are here, though, to celebrate primarily the freedoms we enjoy. Not necessarily just because we're here in the United States of America, because as Dave pointed out, and we've watched over the course of the last, well, many years, but especially the last year, it almost seems as though our country is fractured and split, and we're divided, and we're retreating to our corners, and it just seems like maybe these freedoms that we enjoy are tenuous and at risk. But there is a freedom that you and I, as followers of Jesus, have that's not at risk. Never will it spoil, perish, or fade. As the New City Catechism pointed out, the Holy Spirit, which we are going to be exploring today, grants irrevocably, God grants the Holy Spirit irrevocably to those who call on the name of Jesus, who have been regenerated. And that's not a freedom anyone can take away from us. Nobody can take that away from us. Even Satan, as he roams the earth, and he's got power, right? We heard that in the song. He's got powers. There is none his equal, as Martin Luther says in that great hymn, but he has nothing against Jesus. So, that's what we're here to do today, is let freedom ring and celebrate the freedom that we have. And the title of the message this morning is Born to be Free. So, the scripture reading this morning comes from Galatians chapter 5. I'll read verses 1 and then 13 through 25. It is on page 974 if you want to follow in your pew Bibles. I see a phone or two. there are plenty of resources to read God's word. And as you may notice, I just have a tablet up here. Olive Tree, another one. Sounds like I'm selling apps, but Olive Tree, and there's many online Bibles that you can look at. Olive Tree is a great one. Well, this is the word of the Lord. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Starting with verse 13. For you were called to freedom, brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord endures forever. Father in heaven, would you bless this time now when we turn to your word? May your Spirit illuminate it in our hearts, Lord. And may it bring glory to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for the freedoms that we enjoy by virtue of the fact that we live in this great nation. But we thank you even more, and we praise you for being the source of the freedom that we have that's eternal, that no one can take away from us, Lord. Help us to get a better grasp on that today, to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. So we left off last week with this truth from 2 Corinthians 3:17. Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Three things we'll explore about the Spirit of the Lord and the freedom he provides. Again, thank you, Karen. Again, last week was my first three-point message to today's part two, and it's so I'm going to go with 3 points again today. As it turns out, it provides some structure. I'm not a person of structure, but I always love when structure is provided for me. So, three things we'll explore this morning: the presence, power, and thirdly, the process. So, first, the presence. Last week, in reference to Jesus, the second person of the Holy Trinity, we saw that God called all creation into being through him, right? In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. And it was through Jesus that all things that have been created were created. He was the source. That's clearly stated in John's Gospel, the first three verses. But when we take the Bible as a whole, you know, this thing that is the Trinity, this triune Godhead, three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but one God. It makes your head spin a bit. But what I've seen, when you take a 30,000-foot view of the Bible, what you'll see is that God has revealed himself in kind of a sequential way, right? You see, when God created the heavens and the earth in the beginning, he declared time and time again after each, what's represented as each day of creation, that is good, is good, is good, is good. And after he created man in his own image, he said is very good. But then, of course, something really bad happened, right? John chapter 3, we see the devastation of what happened when sin entered the picture. The world fell into chaos. Adam and Eve were banished from the garden. They were kicked out. And it was as if God, in a sense, because before that, God was like walking in the cool of the day. You recall that scripture? As it turns out, again, the walking in the cool of the day, the original Hebrew, I guess, it meant his spirit, the wind blew. His presence was there by spirit, blew through the garden. Well, after sin came into the picture, it's as if God retreated to heaven. I wouldn't say retreat so much, but he just stepped out of the picture, if you will. Left us on our own, in a sense. And then, amazingly, throughout the rest of the Bible, we see this progression of God moving towards us. First, it was, you see, Moses, later, going up to the mountain, Mount Sinai, to get the law, right? And he could only go there by himself. No one else's foot could touch the mountain, not even animals. They would die. They would perish. God revealed himself through the burning bush and gave Moses the law. And then later, God manifested his presence in the tabernacle, right? The tent in the wilderness, where in the Holy of Holies, that inner sanctuary, God manifested his presence. Later, the same would be true of the temple, the Holy of Holies. And then, of course, we saw last week in my favorite verse of the Bible, the one, in my personal opinion, all of Scripture revolves around, John 1:14. The Word became flesh, made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus traveled the greatest distance ever flown. I say flown. He didn't fly. I sometimes fly. But Jesus traveled from heaven all the way to earth and manifested himself. Took on flesh in that cave or that manger so long ago. And he came to be among us and became human. So God's making his progression towards us, right? Well, then Jesus, through his ministry, and in John, some of you read this week, John chapter 14, Jesus says this to his disciples, John 14:15-17. He says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him. He's talking to his disciples. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Later in John 16, it's recorded, Jesus again saying, nevertheless, I tell you, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. Can you imagine what the disciples were thinking at this point? What do you mean? You know, there was a lot of confusion there. But you know that confusion came to an end? As recorded in Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all gathered together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. Had to have been a scene to behold. And they were all filled. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Imagine. Can you imagine that scene? The manifestation of God's Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, descending, just as Jesus had promised. And the Trinity had progressively come all the way around. God the Father meeting Moses on the mountain. Jesus in a manger. And the Holy Spirit now coming in these, it's like flames coming from people's heads. The disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit, and it gave them the capacity to do things they weren't able to do before. They were speaking in other languages. But here's the things, friends. That wasn't reserved just for those guys. You see, Paul says in Ephesians chapter 1, he says, in him, Jesus, also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, believed in Jesus, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. Isn't that amazing? That God's presence is living within us. It's in our heart. He is in our heart. I had this conversation with a fellow pilot this week, and he referenced this 14th century monk. I don't remember which one it was, but I don't know very many 14th century monks, to be honest with you. But he said that this 14th century monk said that, you know, the Holy Spirit is like this cosmic force. It's a cosmic force between God the Father and God the Son. And I said, I disagree. You see, the Holy Spirit of God, God's Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, he's right here. He's living in my heart. And I didn't say that in a way to be boastful. But I pointed to the words of Jesus. See, Jesus didn't say the Holy Spirit, this cosmic force, is going to come upon. No, he said he will come to you and make his home within you. The Apostle Paul would later say in Romans 8:16, I believe it is, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. We can have this assurance. John, in one of his epistles later, would say the same thing. We have this testimony. We have this presence of God within us. Those of us who have been regenerated, who come to salvation. So the presence of God is here in this room. And the presence of God is not only in us individually, but I believe the presence of God is here in a special way today. Because why? Because where two or more are gathered in his name, in the name of Jesus, he is there with us. Jesus is here today in a special way. And that's why I stand on the conviction that I believe in corporate worship. And for some, maybe tuning in online, it's good to do. It's good to get God's word. But there's something special going on here today. Do you feel it? And it's not really about a feeling. It's just, even if you don't feel it, it's happening. Number two. Secondly, power. Having the Holy Spirit's testimony in your hearts is not about a feeling. It is, in a very real and tangible way, about power. Now, I'm thankful, because I'm not up here on a power trip. But you know what? God is. The Spirit of God has to do with the breaking of the power that of what was before that had control over you. And then to be empowered. You see, friends, before we come to salvation in Christ, what do we have to battle with? The things that war against our soul. Our weapons are limited. Now, you might be able to get a stack of self-help books, listen to, and maybe even believe in some really good principles, take some steps, but all of those things are limited in their power and the scope from which they can battle against that which wars against your heart and your soul. The Bible is extremely clear that before you come to faith in Christ, you are a slave. You're a slave to sin. Now that three-letter word, it might as well be a four-letter word in our culture, because people like to hear it. Maybe we don't, I don't even like to say it sometimes. You know, it's like, but we are confronted with our sin. And the fact is, before we come to faith in Christ, we're just sinners. Right? We're sinners. Now, after we come to faith in Christ, we're still sinners in a sense, but we are sinners that are saved by grace through faith. We've been declared righteous. See, that's the exchange that happens when we come to faith in Christ. Yet to all who believed him, yet to all who received him, as John says, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to be called children of God, children born not of natural descent or your decision or someone else's will, but born of God. And now you have this capacity. And John 8, 31 to 36 says this, referring to the power and the freedom. Jesus said this to the Jews who had believed in him. And I would say he says this to us as well. If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Now get this. Listen to their answer. They answered him, we are the offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? Now, Christy just pointed out while I was sitting in the pew, it's like, I don't know if these Jews had forgotten about Egypt. Remember Egypt? They were in slavery for 400 years. How about Assyria? Assyria took them into captivity, right? What about Babylon? They were dragged into captivity in Babylon. They were slaves. But you know, we have that ignorance too. Back to what they answered. They answered, we are offspring of Abraham, they've never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? Jesus answered them and us when we say the same thing. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. You will be free indeed. And there's a power that comes within us. Jeremy Camp has this song. It's called The Same Power. I encourage you to check that out. It has this chorus. It says, the same power that rose Jesus from the dead, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us. It lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us. Lives in us. He goes on to sing, greater is he who is living in me than he who lives in the world. No power of darkness, no weapon prevails. We stand here in victory. And because he lives in me and he lives in you, when we are together, God again is there in a special way. There is this triune relationship. I thought about this. You know, within the triune Godhead, there's perfect community, right? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. From eternity past, even now, to eternity in the future, there is this perfect unity. And what I've found, that the relationships in my life that are most lasting are triune in nature. It's me. One, for example, is it's me and Christy and Jesus. And I'm confident that Christy would agree with me when we say the most important person in our relationship, in our marriage, is not Dean or Christy. The most important person in our marriage is Jesus. And you'll see that in a lot of, like, marriage ceremonies, there will be a reference to this three-chord strand. You know? This three-chord strand that is held together. It's strong. The writer of Ecclesiastes says this, "And though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him. But a threefold cord is not quickly broken." And I found this, unfortunately, to be the case with some of my friendships. When I've come to the realization that this friendship, it wasn't a threefold cord. This relationship was just a two-party deal. It's easily fractured. Many of you know mine and Christy's testimony. There was a time in our marriage where, summer of 1995, Christy asked me for a divorce. Twice. But that's because at that point in our marriage, we were going it alone. It was just the two of us. And when conflict came and brokenness came and sin entered the picture, the bond nearly broke. Very close to breaking. But now I'm confident that I'm going to spend the rest of my life with this woman. Not because of my willpower, right? Or her willpower. It's because of this third chord in our relationship. It's the person of Jesus and the presence of his Holy Spirit holding us together. It's real, friends. But I think it's also true, again, it's more than just for marriages. My friendship with many of you is just that way. There's a third person here. I grew up in an alcoholic home. And as a young boy, I watched my dad go off to rehab several times, and alcohol had a hold of his life. And it was never really truly broken. But in the last few years, I've come to understand a resource that is available to people who are chemically dependent, to alcoholics. It's called AA, Alcoholics Anonymous. And in AA, they have what's called the big book, Alcoholics Anonymous. The founders of AA, a guy by the name of Bill W. and a doctor, they came up with this 12-step program. And when you look at the 12 steps of AA, you can see how the power of addiction can be broken. Step one says this: we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. Powerless over alcohol. Number two, came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Something outside of ourselves has to restore us to sanity. And then three, made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God, as we understood him. Friends, these three steps, that's not just for AA, is it? I mean, if it's for all of us. We're all powerless over, maybe not alcohol, but there's a blank line there. You think about that. You're powerless when you're, before you come to salvation, you're powerless over some sin. Fill in the blank, whatever it may be. Addiction is one, but you know, bitterness, a spirit of unforgiveness, abuse. Fill in that blank with whatever sin might have had control or still does have control on your life. And in AA, there's also this three, another trinity. With AA, there is three points, I guess, in the recovery process. One is recovery itself. And there's, look up the 12 steps online. It's really good. It's, first is a commitment to recovery. Secondly, it's community. Unity, which comes through community. And then thirdly is service. You see this triune way? That's for us too. And that leads me to a third point is process. So how do we grow spiritually? See, when we're born again, when we're born of the Spirit of God, when we've been declared righteous, we are spiritual infants. Right? Just like a baby, it takes time for a baby to gain strength and ability to crawl and then walk and then run. The same is true for us. And now originally I was going to use practice. The third point was going to be practice. But I realized that was the wrong word. You see, when we talk about the practice of having the Holy Spirit in our life and having the control of the Holy Spirit in our life, that practice sounds like it's something I do. Right? But it's not. So let's pull up the scripture again. Galatians 5. And what I'd like to point out is, won't get it. Okay. Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 in particular. And going forward, what we'll see in scripture is, there you go. Even as believers, you know, we're still human, right? And we still sin. And Paul paints this picture of that there's this struggle between the flesh and against the spirit. Verse 17 says, the desires of the flesh are against the spirit, and the desires of the spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. And then he gives this list. Verse 19 starts with, now the works of the flesh are evident. And there's this long list. And you can look into that list and see if maybe any of those describe any of the struggles that you may have. Verse 21, Paul says, I warn you as I warned you before that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now we need to understand that those who make a practice of doing these things, those who are ruled by these things, which is evident of the fact that they've not been regenerated, that's what he's talking about. And then there's this contrast. But the fruit of the Spirit, which is a singular word, isn't it interesting? The fruit of the Spirit, one fruit, but there are these nine different qualities. He says, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Back in verse 19, it says, the works of the flesh. You see, when we're practicing something, when we're trying to do something, when we're acting out something, those are called works. Now, Paul also says back in Ephesians that we are saved by grace through faith. not by works, that any man would boast. But then verse 10 of Ephesians chapter 2 says, because we were created in Christ Jesus for good works. So we still do things. But see, the thing is, works to gain salvation are not effective. But the works that we do after we're saved provide evidence of what is ruling our hearts. And interestingly enough, when you talk about the fruit of the Spirit, the Apostle Paul and throughout Scripture, there's this application of God's truth by using plant life. Now, when we look out in the fields, isn't it amazing? I used to be knee-high by 4th of July was good, but I mean, we've been really dry, and the corn is quite high. But something is amazing about that is, you know, maybe a month ago we wouldn't have expected that the corn would be as high as it is, and I don't know how well it's doing internally, but you can't see growth, can you? The little ones in your arms there, you can't see her growing, can you? But when you look at her today and compare her to a picture of last year, you can measure growth. There are little lines on, maybe you have got them on your house somewhere where, you know, the little, this is how high you are today and or this year and the next year. And she's like, oh, that guy's talking about me. Sorry. Anyway, we can't see growth, but we can measure growth. And friends, we see outside that the corn has grown. We can measure that growth. Ultimately, we'll come to maturity and we'll harvest that corn. There's a truth, too, in the spiritual sense that we can't see our spiritual growth, but we should be able to measure it. You should be growing in love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. I've actually committed these to memory because here's the thing. We still have this propensity, don't we, to act out of our fleshly nature, our human nature. You see this right here? See that? That might look like a finger to you, but it's not. This is a weapon. This is a weapon. And Kathy's looking at me like, what? Yeah, it's a weapon, Kathy. And I've used it as such before. I've brought customer service representatives to tears with this finger right here. There was one time when Christy's mom had a family ring. It was getting cleaned, right? And somebody from that jewelry company called her mom up and said, this ring isn't real. The diamonds aren't real. And there was this panic. And Christy's mom, the personality that she has, she's not confrontational. But Christy and I rushed over there. I was standing at the counter and I was doing this. Listen, ma'am, you don't understand. This ring has been in her family for decades. I don't know, maybe 100 years. And you don't understand this. And this gal told me, she said, sir, can you put your finger away? That was something like clicked with me on that point. It was like, you know what? That's a weapon. And that doesn't fit in this list of nine. Where's love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control? That's part of my flesh. And it wars against my soul. So I put my finger away. Or I've tried to. I got to say, I used it once last week, too. It's tough. And you know, the Apostle Paul had the same struggle. If you read Romans chapter 7 and chapter 8 in contrast to each other, the Apostle Paul goes into this thing of, you know, it's like, the things I want to do, I don't do, and the things I do, I shouldn't do. He's so frustrated. But then he says, right at the end of chapter 7, who can save me from this body of death? Christ can. And then Romans chapter 8 talks about the life in the Spirit. I encourage you to read that. Life in the Spirit, what it looks like. It's a beautiful thing. The Apostle Paul, of course, wrote, I'll say this in closing, he wrote I believe it was 13 of the New Testament books of the Bible, right? Four of those letters that he wrote from prison. Philippians, Ephesians, Colossians, and this little book, one chapter, of Philemon. And he begins Philemon this way. He says, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. Now, Paul, it's in Paul's writings that we really get a grasp on what freedom in Christ looks like. And Paul is writing this from prison. He's a prisoner. And yet he was free. He was a prisoner for Christ. And amazingly is that Paul writes this letter to Philemon. Philemon was a fellow believer. And evidently, Philemon had this bondservant, a slave, who had stolen from him. His name was Onesimus. Onesimus took what was Philemon's and fled. I don't know what the penalty for that would be in that day. Maybe even death. I don't know. But somewhere along the line, he met the Apostle Paul. And Onesimus came to faith in Jesus. And Paul writes this letter, and he gives it to the hand of Onesimus to bring back to Philemon. And in this letter, he says, appealing for Onesimus. He says, for love's sake, I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man now and a prisoner also for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I became in my imprisonment. The Apostle Paul discipled Onesimus, brought him up in the faith. He later says, but I preferred to do nothing without your consent in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but of your own accord. For this perhaps is why he, Onesimus, was parted for you for a while, that you might have him back forever, no longer as a bondservant, a slave, but more than a bondservant, as a beloved brother, especially to me. But how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. It's not clear what happens, but I've got to believe Philemon took Onesimus in. Because Onesimus had been freed from the bondage of sin and death. He was now a co-heir with Christ Jesus of eternal life. Friends, if you've placed your faith in Christ, you are a co-heir along with Philemon and Paul and Onesimus and Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And the saints of old, and the saints today. This 4th of July, let us let freedom ring in our hearts, knowing that we are free, and that we are free indeed. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we give you praise, Lord, for you are worthy, and only you, Lord, could free us from the bondage of sin and death that our own sin had on us. Lord, you created the heavens and the earth. You walked in the garden with your people, Adam and Eve. Sin came in, you retreated to heaven, and you made your way back to us, and you are residing within each and every believer's heart right now. God, I pray that we would grasp that. And that we would commune with you. And in those moments, Lord, when we feel all alone, when we feel as though no one is on our side, no one understands, when sometimes those twofold cords are broken, God, I pray that you would help us to grasp how deep and wide the love of Christ is. And help us to live lives that reflect your glory with the assurance of your presence. Give us the power God, to do what you are calling us to do. And help us grow in the process of sanctification, which is becoming more like our Savior Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. So our responsive worship will be Great Hymns of Faith, 257. 'Tis so sweet to trust the name of Jesus. Let us sing.
And stand.
Now, celebrating the freedom that we enjoy, that we walk in, let us go here proclaiming that freedom and living that freedom. Receive God's benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And one more. Paul ends his second letter to the Corinthians by saying this. He says, "The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Go in peace. Happy 4th of July.
Sure. How Pastor Luke does that every week.